one last sniff of summer. Goodbye, summer. It's kind of a sad time. It is that day, folks. Yeah. I knew it was coming. I really wasn't looking forward to it, but you can't stop the seasons. It's October, of course, and the seasons have run their course. Now it's time for autumn. And that means that it's time to start getting ready for winter here in Iowa. One of the things that I have to do to get ready for winter is to cut back the butterfly bush. This is the butterfly bush that I started from an itty-bitty seed. Remember back in the Voodoo Garden, those of you who tuned into the Voodoo Garden, and it turned into this little itty-bitty plant, and then I pruned it, and it looked really beautiful. I brought it outside. It grew wild. Look at this. And this is after I've pruned it. Yeah, this is the first season of this thing, and at the risk of repeating myself, I'm going to show you this for about the 100th time. This is what a butterfly bush does. It puts out these sets of flowers. This is a spent flower, so just look at this one. And these other ones around here, they smell very much like lilacs. They look very much like lilacs. The one big difference is that this will bloom all the way, all through the season, from spring all the way until frost. What you do, and this is what the advice that I got from folks, is that yet whenever the flowers die off, when they're done blooming, they don't stay bloomed for very long. When the flower dies, cut it off and you'll get more. Cut it off, you'll get more. You just keep getting more. Boy, was that the best advice I've gotten all year. Thing is that some people don't really much care for these because they say they're invasive. And that's not an argument I choose to get into today. This is a bush that I chose to grow here, whether anybody likes it or not. This is my yard. I'll grow what I please as long as it's legal, and this is legal. Now what I'm doing is taking everything off, even though there are some blooms still on here. By the way, when I was setting up the camera, there was a couple monarchs that were fluttering around here getting one last little bit of pollen before the season's over, heading on their way to Mexico. Boy, they better hurry, because if they're in Iowa tonight, they're not going to make it to Mexico. So I'm cutting this back because that's what you're supposed to do to these. Cut them back sharply. And then, especially here in Iowa, because the wind will take these dead brittle branches and snap them, and it could harm the tree. So any plant that's going to be harmed like that, I have to cut it back, and that will make it sturdier for the winter. You notice at the very, there goes a monarch right now. Sorry, I took all your food. Yep, they're hey, how you doing? One right here. Yep, but when the wind blows through here, it'll definitely just snap it off. You saw at the beginning of the program how this thing was going like that. Well, this is a mildly windy day. This is nothing like the hurricane force winds that we get here in early spring and throughout the winter. There are so many of these monarchs all over the place here. It's crazy. In the autumn, they're everywhere, and there's not a thing to eat. The thing is, they better get their butts in gear and get out of here. Well, anyway, back to what I was doing. This is one of the many tasks I have to do today. Even though I don't really much feel like doing a whole heck of a lot, I'll have to explain that to you. This is Sunday's program, and on Wednesday, I normally have a question and answer. Ever since I finished the book, I have Q&A. Well, I have a special one coming up this Wednesday, and you might want to tune in for that. There was an incident, so I'm kind of taking things a little bit easy. I'll tell you about that on Wednesday. Today, I'm not going to be talking about that because I have too many things to do. When a frost comes, of course, I have to get ready to take this down because of the wind, but I also need to harvest a few things because of the cold, and that's what I'm about to do. Whew, that's a lot colder than it looks. You'd think with the sun shining out, it would be nice and toasty. No, I got a thermal shirt on, a t-shirt on, thermal underwear, a coat. I'm cold. My hands are cold. Thing is, I can't do this with gloves on. I have to have the maneuverability of my fingers, and my gloves are set for winter. They're real thick gloves, so I can't be doing a lot of this with gloves. I have to pick all these peppers. I have to pick all the tomatoes. Tomatoes will not survive a frost. You can, of course, you can cover them up and stuff. I'm not into doing that with my tomatoes. I would just as soon pick them all, let them ripen inside, and you can do that. I'll be getting to that in a second. Now, also, what I need to do is I need to pick all the peppers, because pepper plants don't handle frost very well at all. As a matter of fact, as soon as you have a frost, your pepper leaves will all be translucent and they'll wilt. That means it's tostada for your pepper plant, and you might as well yank it up. So I figure, well, If I'm going to be picking all the peppers and call it in a year, I might as well go ahead and pull up the plant and see what kind of a plant it was. I didn't rehearse this, so I don't really know what I'm doing. But then again, I seem to have the most fun when I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just going to plant my foot right here and grab the plant and try to keep my head level because I can't tilt my head down. I'll explain that on Wednesday. This is a weird harvesting year. It would have been nice if today would have been a warm day. Wouldn't that be nice? You get a warning of a frost and you have a nice warm day where you can just take your time out in the garden and take care of things. Oh, no, 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 no. Not here in Iowa. Not this year. No, we shan't be having that. It's a matter of get it done and get it done quickly and freeze your tootsies off while you're doing it. Hey, look at the roots. Not bad. Now, I'm going to bring this out. I think we'll just go over to the picnic table, okay? So you back it up. I'm coming over here. Make sure I don't fall off anything. I'll meet you at the picnic table, okay? Whoa. Whoa. Hold on there. Yeah, this wind doesn't make it any easier. But then again, I guess easy isn't part of the game today. This is the pepper plant. Yes, it is. Look at that. Isn't that a beauty? Whoa. Okay, now it's starting to snap from the wind. You know what? I need a wheelbarrow. Isn't that a nice close-up? This is the Pusa Juala. Yes, I've mentioned it many, many times. It has really impressed me this season. Now you can get a really good up-close and personal look at this. Here's the root system. Nothing really that spectacular, but then again, I wasn't going for a great root system. It did well enough. The trunk on this was sturdy. Look at that. One little short trunk. It wasn't one tall one. I pruned it off way back in the day, and what we ended up getting is my hand in your face. No, what we ended up getting was a lot of branches coming off like that, and that's what I wanted. I want a low center of gravity for this. That way it wouldn't snap in half, and also if a branch snapped off in our strong breezes, it wouldn't mean the end of this plant. And that's exactly what we got here. Look at this. It's already mid-October, and the plant is still absolutely overloaded with wind, with... Jeez, Ray, could you possibly pick a less windy day? Well, no, I can't. That's the problem. The winds have been going through here like mad, but it still has an overabundance of peppers, flowers. The peppers are green, they're red, they're all shades in between. I have a lot of picking left to do, and you saw me before. I was picking all kinds of peppers before. I'm not nearly done now. Now, I can't take this inside. You might be, some people might be wondering, why don't you just take the plant inside? Whoa, there you go. Hold on. Why don't you just take the plant inside and grow it in the winter? Well, those of you who know the answer, you might want to answer their question right here in the comment section, because I'm sure I'm going to get a lot of that. But I'll answer you really quick. I don't bring any plants inside that have been outside. It's a one-way street. Once plants go outside, they don't come inside because there's too much of a chance of insects. Even if I treat them, there's still too much of a chance of insects. So this plant is done. It's not going anywhere except for over the hill or into the compost pile. But the peppers, oh, the peppers I have plans for. And you're going to have to stay tuned in to find out what that plan is. I'm not just throwing them away. I have a very good use for these. Well, as much fun as that was, I got to get down to business now. No messing around. I have a lot to do and very little time to do it. The end of the season tomatoes are always the ugliest, aren't they? They're all half chewed by the rodents and the bugs and stuff. And I just, ooh, okay, sorry. I just heave them over the coop into the fenced yard and the chickens munch on those. Nothing goes to waste around here. But what I have to do is, I don't just look around for the ripe ones. I look around for all the tomatoes, because no tomatoes are going to survive the cold temperatures that we're going to have tonight. And this has been one heck of an experience with the tomato plants. They're still growing and still flowering and still doing fine. If I wanted to, now if you wanted to, if you're growing tomato plants and you want to continue this and you have somewhere inside by like a southern sunny window, or you have some grow lights going on, all you really have to do is, well, it can't be me because I don't have any clippers. Just snip off about a 1-foot section and Let's just pretend these are snippers, okay? There you go. Take your snippers, take off all of the leaves down to the main stem, right like that. And remember, use snippers. Don't tear them like I'm doing here, because that's just not good for the plant. Now what you'll do is you'll take about a 1 foot section and try not to fall off of here. Cut this at an angle, a slight angle, with your clippers. Cut off all the leaves. Leave just a couple at the top. Take a large pot of soil. You're going to need a large pot of soil if you're going to be growing this inside. I'd say around a 16-inch pot or a 5-gallon pot. And you bury this in soil all the way up to the growing tip here. It looks ridiculous, but what you're going to end up having all kinds of roots growing in here. Or if you don't have the soil right off the bat, if you want to hurry up and just get this in the house, make sure you spray these off with water very carefully. There could be all kinds of insects anywhere on these leaves, whether you see it or not. There's also eggs. In the fall, bugs will lay their eggs on plants and in the dead leaves of plants. So make sure you spray this really well with a hose, nice and good, to make sure you get all the bugs off of there. Get the stem as well. There could be eggs on the stem, spider mites, aphids. You don't need that in your house. Put this in a jug of water all the way up to here for about maybe 2 weeks, and then you'll have roots, then you can plant it. Not a problem at all. Either way, whichever you're more comfortable with, and you can continue your plants growing throughout the winter, and then next spring, bring them right back out. That way, if you have a nice plant that may be a hybrid, and you know, hybrids don't normally breed true to their seeds, most of them don't. If you have a hybrid, this is one way that you can continue growing that plant and have tomatoes forever, because if you save the seeds, you may not get the same thing that the plant was. There's a quick, easy tip for you for keeping your plants going. Now, if you have chickens, or you have goats, or if you have bad neighbors, the Ray method. Ooh, that's a good one. Run, chickens. It's food. But yeah, I got to get these things out of here. And then I pick up the tomato plants. I pull them out by the roots. I can't do that right now because I have all these strings that's trussed up to these metal bars. A way that I was trying to keep it holding up together did not work. If you had that on your bookmarks of things to go by for tips, knock it off of there, because it didn't work for me. This plant outgrew any means of support I could have imagined. It was a very good success as far as growing. Hey, little R, how you doing? And little R comes through here and looks for the mice, because the mice in the fall are looking for a place to live. So why am I standing off to the side? I should be over here talking to you. In the autumn, when you're clearing out your garden, make sure that you get everything out of your garden. Don't be lazy. Don't leave everything laying there to die and just to lay on your garden. Mice, rodents will look for, and also insects will look for places to hide throughout the winter, to overwinter. And the rodents can make nests and burrow underneath these plants. You want to make sure you get all this crap off of here. Now, tomato plants. If you have tomato plants that have blight, late season blight, and insects on them, don't worry about composting them. Go ahead and take them, shred them up, tear them up, stomp them down, whatever you need to do. Get them into a compost pile. Then in the spring, when you add stuff to it, as long as your compost pile heats up to a nominal temperature for compost, it will kill that fungus and those spores on the tomato plants. I've heard so many people say, don't compost plants that have blight on them. I've always done that, and I've never had an issue. So take it for what it's worth. Either you can do it or not do it. It really doesn't matter to me. I'm just telling you how I do it. I always compost these. Nothing goes to waste. This is compost material. This is wonderful stuff that's going to feed my soil. So I throw it all in a pile, and then in the spring, I start my compost pile, and the tomato plants get all turned into compost. Those of you who actually bought some of the compost, some of that was tomato plants. Yeah, so you're actually using my tomato plants to feed your plants. What a hoot. Okay. I need to get some tomatoes into a bucket, so I will join you in just a few minutes, okay? The sunchokes are in full bloom, and that's one of the things that are still giving the monarchs their last little bit of energy. This is a monarch up close and personal here out on the farm. Yep. Giving them their last little boost from my farm so that they can make their pilgrimage south. And they really do swarm these flowers. So this is what I'm doing, my little tiny bit to help the insects along in the autumn. Isn't that something? One of the downsides of autumn is that the flies are all over the place. They're desperate for some place to hide from old man winter. And as much as I like nature, I really don't much have any sympathy for these flies. Go meet your maker. You're done here. Now, pumpkins are very susceptible to the cold. If you have any kind of vining crops, they're pretty much kaput when the frost hits. Unless, of course, you protect them, which I don't. These leaves will wilt so fast when the cold temperatures hit tonight. And once the leaves wilt, this vine is done. So, that means, yes, you know what it means, Ray has to harvest a pumpkin again. And this one is looking pretty good. Now, I mentioned, I think in the last episode, you're supposed to take your fingernail and press in on the pumpkin. Well, this one is still very soft, which, and it's a white one. It's not one of the yellow ones. And the soft rind means that it's still growing. There's nothing I can do about that. It has to come out because the frost is coming. So I need to get this thing out of here. I don't know what the frost is going to do for this soft rind. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll this big lemon drop out of here and go. No, I'm not going to be stupid this time. This time I'm going to go get the wheelbarrow because there's no way in this world I'm carrying this big thing up that hill. But I wanted to show you this so that you can see this big thing that grew from the seeds that Scott gave me. Pepper roots. They do have an original aroma all their own, and I like it. I think it's because it smells like dirt. Yeah, I'm a big dirt kind of guy. Well, I did pick a few sample tomatoes. I didn't pick them all because I don't want to deal with that right now. I'm going to do that later. As soon as the camera's done and I got the microphone off me, Mike and I and me and probably even Rascal is going to get out here and we're going to pick our tomatoes. Check it out. The pumpkin. Yep. This is the twin to this one. Now, these two, let me back up so you can see them. These two came from the same batch of seeds from the same guy. Yeah. So that's kind of odd. One of them comes out perfectly orange. One of them turns out looking more like a lemon than anything. I grew the world's largest lemon. But yeah, it's a beauty. I like it. I'm not going to harvest seeds from these yet. I want to give this some time to cure. I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but I want to put it in the basement. I sprayed it off, made sure all the insects are off of it. I'm going to let it set out here for about a day or so. Then I'm going to take it inside in the basement and let it set for a little bit just in case the seeds inside need to finish ripening. I don't know if that'll help them, but that's what I'm gonna do. One last thing. I don't know if I'm talking too loud, but the wind's just roaring through here, so that's why I tend to yell. But when you're harvesting the last of your peppers and the last of your tomatoes, those two things especially, even if they're not fully ripe, like the peppers, if they're still green, pick them. It's better to pick them than to go out the next morning and find out the frost hit them, because once the frost hits them, they'll start to get that. You won't see it right off the bat. The leaves will wilt right off the bat. But the fruits themselves, it'll get that translucentish looking look to the flesh, and then it'll start getting soft after a day or so. That means they got frost damage and they're going to start rotting right away. You can eat them, but you better eat them really quick or freeze them really quick, because they're not going to stay firm for very long. That's the same thing with tomatoes. The tomato plant will wilt and die. The fruits, once the frost hits them, they're going to start turning translucent and starting to rot. They will not last if you pick them after they've been hit by frost. Even if you let them set on the table, if a good frost hits them, that's the end of them. So you might as well just toss them in the compost pile. And I've done that quite a few times. Yeah. I've composted more tomatoes than I can remember. But you know, the end of the season tomatoes aren't going to be that pretty. Don't worry about it. Now, I'm going to show you something that's probably going to make you feel better. It's not going to make me feel any better, but as long as you're feeling better, that's really all that matters to me. See? That's not too pretty. But that's an end of the season tomato for me, because the temperatures start going up and down and up and down, and the moisture level is very erratic. I can't control that when the temperatures get cooler. So I start getting cracking on my tomatoes, but still, they're in good condition. This one is right on the verge of turning a yellowish. It's not solid green, okay? There's one. Here's an example of one that's solid green. It still looks good, but it's a nice solid green. And you may have heard from some sources, and I don't know what sources, but I've heard it before, that if they're solid green, they're not gonna ripen. Hogwash. All tomatoes will ripen. practically every tomato that you pick, whether it's solid green, translucent green, yellow, red, it doesn't matter. Put them on a towel on your kitchen table. You can put them in direct sunlight or you don't have to. You know what? Doesn't matter. You just place them there and they will slowly ripen. And then you're wondering, you know, like after a week or so, are these ever going to ripen? Then you wake up one morning and they're all this color. Well, they're not this size. They're not going to shrink this much. But see, you get them in all different forms of ripeness. See, this one's not quite ripe. This one's fully ripe. And look at how small it is. You'll be getting the weird ones at the end of the season. And here's my giant lemon drop. Isn't it nice? Yep, it's the twin, so to speak, of the other one. So now I have two pumpkins. Thank you to Scott. I really do appreciate this. And by the way, look at how fat this is. That's really nice. I'm going to roll it over so you can look at its butt because, you know, that's what we do here. See, that's in a lot better condition than the other one. Yep, no rot going on, no nothing. The other one didn't have it either. But this one has a softer rind, and this is what I'm talking about. I can barely push in on that. It doesn't damage it, but you can see the little dent. The other one doesn't do that. So this one had a soft rind, which means it was still capable of growing and expanding. Problem is, it doesn't have the time to do that. Yep, I didn't have enough time to grow a record-setting pumpkin here in Iowa, but you know what? I'm happy. I got no complaints whatsoever. It's going to be a great holiday here out on the farm. Well, I think that pretty much does it for today. Little Art gets cold real easy because he's so itty-bitty and he doesn't have a whole lot of fat on him. But I hope you enjoyed today's harvest and my mad rush to get everything ready. I will have a Q&A, not this coming up Wednesday, but the Wednesday after that. Because I have something I want to tell you this Wednesday about why things are a little bit odd today and why I'm kind of taking it a little bit slow. But if you have any questions concerning your autumn garden or anything autumn, boy, it is the picture perfect autumn out here. Breezy, leaves falling, the smell in the air, the harvest is going on across the street. The farmers are just crazy to get their corn in. But that's what it is. That's what it's like out here in Iowa. You like that, huh? You like the wind in your nose. His little nose is going back and forth. Anyway, thank you for joining me out here on the farm. I really do appreciate it. Have a great day, everybody. You want to go have a great day, baby? Let's go play. Yeah, let's go.